Finding out about important issues, issues, and people in outstanding programs here in the Loudoun County, and I'm your host, Paul Minicucci. Tonight, we have a very special group of guests, Harold Hartman, who many people will recall as a very successful and ongoing Loudoun County Meltdown, and who's the author of From Back to Here. And she's joined by California AARP President David Pacheco and John Curtis, a community organizing expert. We'll talk more about what he does. The subject of our program tonight is to take this very successful intervention at the local level and find a way to make it go as well across the country and work with partnership in these projects. So, and you'll find that we talk about the project that from the community meltdown is a community intervention and a project that really depends upon shifting the norm of a culture and social. Ideas, and it is what is known as social marketing in the field.
So,
David, John, welcome to our studio.
Thank you.
Now, normally, we go right into the subject, but I'd like to have people get to know you guys a little bit better. So, I'm going to tell you where you grew up.
Oh, I'm a farm girl from Iowa.
From Iowa?
My adaptive ball playing farm girl from Iowa.
Oh, good. Well, how did you end up in the foothills of California?
I got married, worked at the area for about 30 years, and then retired up here.
Mm-hmm. What were you doing?
Oh, you know, I did a lot of things, but for the last 20 years, I was a person who worked for venture capitalists doing startups and turnarounds. So I like to work for a lot of different companies.
So, in that capacity, you had to be a self-starter.
I had to figure out what was wrong very quickly and get it fixed and make some changes.
So that was a good statement there.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah. As we were talking about before the show started about second and third careers, and often we draw upon those things. So I know that you've also done work as a journalist. Pretty much after you started with it.
That's right. When I decided to get sick, I chronicled my experience in a local newspaper, The Union, and then it was after that that I invited people to join me in getting sick. And then later I wrote a book and then a manual, so it really launched my writing career.
Great. The thing is, you know, AARP, as we mentioned, is one of my very favorite organizations here, serving the legislature, and the friend of Tom Porter. Staff person in California. How did you end up being associated with AARP?
I've been the state president just since May, so I'm relatively new as state president, but I've been working with AARP for about the past 4 years as a member of their executive council. First became interested in AARP when my mother was going through her last year of her life and some of the challenges that we went through at that time. Got me excited about finding out what kind of care do we need in the later years of life, and that kind of led me into AARP. I'm a volunteer, right? I'm considered the lead volunteer for the state. We have 3.1 million members here in California, and so we're the largest membership group of all the states. And my work is primarily on the policy side. Not necessarily the product side, but we all get in the mail That's right. I had a dual career. I grew up in Santa Clara Valley, but came in the late 70s to Sacramento on a fellowship to work with the legislature, and now I run a fellowship program for the state.
Okay. So, John, tell me how you ended up working with this federal school.
I've been involved in the health community up here for forever. I bought a business called Empire Home Medical in 1985 and operated it until 2003 when I sold it. And saw a lot of people in very serious chronic conditions. I've been pretty much a health advocate my whole life. And just kind of stepped into this. Heard Carol was pulling off. I saw the article in the paper about what she was doing for herself, and that didn't we know a lot of the same people. We didn't know each other at the time, but we knew a lot of the same people. And I think it was Debbie Wagner that probably talked me into was wellness coordinator at the Sierra Nevada Memorial Hospital to get involved with it. I know that we were all getting this stuff to school. It was a fun experience, and one I will cherish forever. And thank you, Carol.
One thing you have, I'm going to open up the issue we're talking about by reading a reading from the book. I was talking to Joel Harris, actually, Carol's book. From that, and we're going to show that up on the screen so people can see it. Thank you. And this is a really good way to get people involved. So I'm going to read a couple sentences so with your permission. I saw the light of the fog. I'm willing to put an underwear on underwear because it might have an extra ounce or two. I should have taken it on the bathroom scale. Sucking in my stomach and holding my breath, I waited for the number that would determine my outlook for the day. Yesterday, my tablet one day registered 179 pounds. Size 16 clothes were tight. A few sort of 18 tops had sneaked into my closet. What would today bring? No number appeared on the scale. I stepped off. I'm off the scale several times before realizing the scale was broken. Is there a message here? Disheartened, I looked up. Half expected God's voice to break through the scene. The bathroom was quiet. I heard only my own voice filled with self-loathing. How could you have gotten this stuff? This morning, I went through the same ritual with near and more accurate scale. But now, I weigh 182 pounds, 3 pounds more. More desperation and condition, if you don't change, you'll die fat. You have to do something before you hate. And then, with Donna, you decided to find a trainer, a local trainer, whose name was
Joe Austin.
And can you break into the gym and tell us what happened?
Well, the video tells me it's very good. So if we can go to the end of the video, then we begin with our reunion. 6 years later, from the meltdown, begins with a picture because we assembled everybody for our reunion. But it doesn't include my story. So.
Great. Okay, we'll roll the video. Enjoy.
We celebrated our 6-year reunion, and we declared ourselves the prettiest little county in the USA. This remarkable journey started 8 years ago when I got up one morning, stepped on the scales I usually did naked because I didn't want to add any jewelry or underwear to add extra weight. I stepped on the scale, and it broke. And with it, it took my system of pretending that I wasn't overweight. I wasn't just pudgy, I was fat. So I decided to get fit, and from that, the meltdown eventually occurred. Now, I haven't been honest with the Department of Motor Vehicles for about 40 years. I lied about my weight. My husband didn't even know my weight. But this time, I decided I was going to do something about it. But I wasn't just going to focus on weight. I was going to get fit, and I would follow three principles, F-I-T. I'd make it fun. I'd find fun foods that I love to eat that wouldn't pack on pounds. I'd find fun exercise that I love to do that I would do even if I weren't trying to lose weight. and one that I could sustain for the rest of my life. I would do what was right for me. I would individualize the program. I had a torn hamstring at the time, so I had to be really careful about what I did. And maybe most importantly of all, I would team up with other people. I would do it together. I wouldn't try and do it alone. I offered to chronicle my experience in the local newspaper. And each week they reported my measurements, my weight, and whatever exercise I had tackled for the week. I tried Pilates, yoga, kickboxing, spinning, jogging, tennis. I tried every exercise I can imagine because I was on a mission to find the one that worked really well for me, one that I could enjoy and that I would do no matter what for the rest of my life. After doing this for a little while, I offered to lead teach a little workshop on how to lose weight and get fit. I didn't expect much of a turnout because, after all, it was going to be winter and we had a lot of seniors who don't like to drive at night, certainly not in snow. And we have a lot of families that have to put their kids to bed because they're school the next day. So I wasn't expecting much of a turnout. Imagine my surprise when over 1,000 people showed up on the first night of what later became the Nevada County Meltdown. So on the first night, we organized everybody into a team. We had incredible teams that were created. Sometimes they were neighbors who'd come together. Sometimes they were strangers that formed teams. But we had wonderful teams that developed. Each week we grew, and we ended up with over 200 teams, and we lost nearly 4 tons in 8 weeks. And we demonstrated how much weight that was when on the last night we drove in a school bus that weighed about 4 tons, filled with school bus riders, the Durham Dolls that made up a wonderful team, and we celebrated our success on this last evening. Well, could we take what we've learned and make it available to other communities? Would other communities follow our example? To make sure that happened, I wrote a book, From Fat to Fit, Turn Yourself into a Weapon of Mass Reduction. I also wrote a manual that detailed all the steps that we went through to create our own event. Since the Nevada County Meltdown occurred, over 300 communities have followed our example and have organized in one way or another their own weight loss event. In addition, I've given dozens of interviews, if not hundreds, and encouraged individuals and communities throughout the United States, even internationally, to undertake their own weight loss challenges. I wrote this manual with step-by-step instructions from which you can successfully organize and lead your own community meltdown. This down-to-earth manual explains how to assemble a core team of committed volunteers, and how to involve every part of your community, how to form dozens of wonderful teams and track their progress, how to publicize your event from kickoff to the final celebration, how to keep the event alive, and finally, how to advocate for health and well-being in your community. In this nuts and bolts manual, you'll find information, resources, and more to stage a fabulous community meltdown that's exactly right for your group. Everything you need to stage an unforgettable event. Since writing this manual, I've been in touch with over 400 communities who created their own community meltdowns. We were the pioneers, and we were happy to create a model that others could follow. I accepted the challenge to become a catalyst for fitness in my community 6 years ago, and I'm excited that the spirit of our meltdown is still alive today. But I'm even more excited about how we can share this program with others. We'll be right back.
explain that was just a really upbeat way of looking at this. And, you know, bullying is the old fashioned way of doing it. It's a million all day.
So fun.
Yeah, I mean, I gotta get up and eat myself and that's why that doesn't work. And you're taking a wholly different approach. And we're talking the other day. This is very much akin to what happened in the anti-smoking movement. And that we talked about social marketing and talked about social ownership. What's that all about?
Well, I think right now, two-thirds of us are overweight, obese, and what we need to do is shift it the other way and make that be the norm. Mm-hmm. But to do that, we're going to have to make it fun. Mm-hmm. We're going to have to encourage people who was right for them, and then we got to do it together. One of the programs that came out of this work so far is the AARP Fat to Fit online community. We've grown to 18,000 people, and we follow those same principles, and the changes in people's lives are just fabulous.
So we are looking at a kind of an epidemic here. The data that we have, we're going to show a little slide. It's really amazing that among people men over 65, 85% of them are obese and thus overweight. And women are about the same. So as a friend of ARP, taking a poll of ARP, how did ARP get involved in this meltdown?
Well, we've been involved in numerous activities for the 50-plus population for a number of years. Carol, the better spokesperson for how the act is connected with the meltdown, but it coincides with what we've been doing, trying to get people engaged in all sorts of different activities. The simplest things is walking in group activity and expanding it on as an entry level exercise that takes you into yoga. It's obvious that for our membership, staying healthy and fit and having a group peer situation where people can come together and have the camaraderie to work together collectively, by yourself, it's real hard to try and stick to a regimen or a schedule. But with the group activities that this the meltdown or a number of other different activities that ARP sponsors, you've got that connectivity and someone to share the pain and the gain.
So, John, how do you work in the community? I mean, in community intervention, what do you think you organize the community to be able to take part in the meltdown?
Well, it wasn't hard. I think, people were inspired if we're talking about the original meltdown, mm-hmm. like, Carol's chronicling of her experiences. I think the team approach is the best way to approach it as well. I mean, I think that was the most amazing dynamic about that whole event was how the teams formed and competed with each other for week after week and how much weight they lost. But looking at our community now, I see it from a whole different standpoint. I've been involved in the Sierra Nevada Community Health Plan. We've been looking at health and wellness education for a number of years, and I attended a conference at the Avalon Culling Library a couple of weeks ago, and I think it's fair to say that we're all in the kind of baby boomer generation. There's a silver tsunami heading for healthcare, and if these numbers are accurate, which I'm sure they are, because it was an economist that provided this data, our healthcare system is going to be in big trouble unless we start taking better care of ourselves, and it's already catastrophic levels. I mean, you just look at the cost of healthcare and the cost of insurance, all these things. It's a simple solution to the problem. It's to take responsibility for yourself, team up with friends and family, and make it happen.
Because we did it. Right. And so it's not only about the vanity of losing weight and looking better, but there's so many health things that you can't really do. Diabetes, high blood pressure, what are some of the other?
80% of the chronic illnesses now they've linked to lifestyle. And although vanity was my motivation, I discovered later on that I was in the 90th percentile for heart disease, cancer, stroke, and diabetes. Wouldn't be alive sitting here today if I hadn't made those changes. So vanity is an issue, health is another issue, but people report so many other benefits. depression goes away, their outlook improves, they sleep better, they feel better in their body throughout the day. I think the thing that I get from working with the AARP at the community and also with the individuals I coach is to recognize that these changes sooner. This is wonderful. But as long as you have the notion that it's grim and horrible and awful, it's difficult to implement these changes. But when we form a group and we hold each other accountable, oh my gosh, our lives are transformed. Literally transformed.
Right. And so your message is you don't have to do this alone, but you probably can't do it alone.
I think it's too hard to do it alone. And when people write me and say, I've been trying to do it alone, and I can't, how am I feeling? I say, you are feeling. I didn't learn to write without having a teacher to teach me to write. We all need teachers and coaches. So it's all right. And also we need people to hold us accountable.
Right. I used to work in the workplace here in aging and long-term care, and there's a lot we don't know because no generation has been this large that has the prognosis of growing older. But if we grow old and we're not fit, that's going to cause a tremendous effect on our health care at the critical care level and on down.
Although we know this, and we can't wait for government intervention or legislation or anything else, we have to come back to now ourselves.
Right. So how does this help if we shift the norm? I mean, if I see myself now not as being one person alone, but actually I look out in society, and the norm is not to go to fast food places or
eating healthy food.
And
exercising every day.
Right.
Wouldn't that make life a lot easier?
It would. And what was really disturbing and difficult for me always in looking at this issue has been it would be one thing if we're on a level playing field, but actually, with the food industry, doing what it does in video certainly makes it more appealing. When you have any number of tremendous calories looking at the back to the restaurant it is, and yet that seems to be the norm. And I think one of the jobs we have to do is change that, don't we?
We have to educate ourselves, first of all, because we always have choices in what we put in our mouth. And if you look at some of the changes, they're starting to add some healthy options so that you can eat healthy, but you may have to make an effort. Maybe the default option. You may have to ask for the fruit instead of the fries, but it is available to you now. But I think the importance of hanging out with like-minded people cannot be underestimated.
Right.
If I go out to eat with someone who eats very healthfully, I'll tend to meet with them. Our friends, research these policies, our friends make us sick, our friends make us fat. Take your friends carefully, be influenced them.
Right. Now, unfortunately, only 2 minutes left, it's amazing how fast time flies. So, for me, it's your perspective. What's the one thing people need to do? If you're on an ARP member with them, what are you going to tell me that I should do first?
Get off your chair and get out and walk. Walking is the simplest thing you can do in the world. It's the entry level to a lot of other exercises. You can do it as a group. There's group activities. You can get to it at aarp.org/walking. We have a number of different exercises that you can do to get out of your chair, stay active. For the retirement community and for those of us that are approaching retirement, now's the time to take responsibility for your health. We're not going to be the image of the rocking chair generation that we had of our grandparents.
Rock and roll, not rocking chair.
Stay positive. Stay positive, imagine yourself healthy. Visualize yourself as a healthy person and you get there.
Mm-hmm. Yourself and then call me.
Is there anything that's special about any community religion?
Any community, anything that's part of the community, it could be a church community, could be a place where you work, could be a Facebook community, like the data economy, or it could be an online community.
Mm-hmm.
But we have the tools to help communities make these changes.
And speaking of tools, I know how many communities don't have to work with. The manual, which is really a helpful tool for the community to get through this, whether they have a a really organized way of getting involved in this and becoming sick. And as you saw with the pictures, 6 years later, the community really has embraced this, and the union is really amazing.
So it's exciting to see the changes in people's lives. Oh, my goodness. Oh, so exciting.
Well, I want to thank you guys for coming over, and I hope this tape will be helpful. We'll get out as many places as we can. Just know that I've written a letter to my SFPD cohorts around the country to urge communities around the country to embrace this. So that's about all we have time for today. Thank you, David, John, Christy, and Carol.
Thank you.
And look forward to keeping fit, call Carol right now. That's all we have time for today. Thanks to the crew, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you.